So we've been discussing how loop transformations are very important for compiler optimization. But before we even talk about optimization of a loop, we need to define what is a loop, right? And we want to define a loop in graph theoretic terms on the control flow graph. And why do we want to do that? Because we want to have as canonical a representation of the loop as possible. So we don't want to be sensitive to input syntax, such as whether it's a for loop or a while loop or a repeat until loop or a do while loop. We don't want algorithms that work differently on different types of loops, right? We don't want a special algorithm for for loop. We don't want another special algorithm for while loop and so on. That would increase the complexity of the compiler further. And one of the very fundamental ideas in trying to reduce the complexity of a compiler is canonicalization. So you want to canonicalize the structure of the program so that, you know, there's many different types of programs, many different source level structures of the program map to the same canonical structure, and so you can have a single algorithm for that canonical structure. In fact, the whole idea of intermediate representation is also a sort of canonicalization. There can be multiple languages with different syntaxes, but you have one single IR that, or you know, at least a few different IRs, fewer than the number of source languages, that capture the essence of the program, but maybe lose some information, but give you a canonical representation of the program. So similarly, we are interested in a canonical representation of the loop, which is not sensitive to the input syntax. So we can have a uniform treatment for all loops and don't have to worry about exact syntax of the original loop. Okay, so informally, we are going to define a loop, and it's not just to basically, you know, distinguish a loop from a cycle. We are going to actually call it a natural loop. All right, so it will become clear. A natural loop has edges that form at least one cycle. So typically when we say a loop, we basically mean that, you know, we are basically using the word loop and cycle interchangeably, right? But a natural loop, which is what we mean by a loop actually, for doing compiler optimization, is that it should also have a single entry point. Okay, so there are two requirements for it to be a natural loop, or even, I mean, I can also just call it a loop, but you know, typically loop and cycle are confused, so I'm using the word natural loop. So there are two requirements. A, there should the set of edges. So what is a loop? A loop is a set of nodes and edges. And the requirements are that the edges should form at least one cycle, and there should be a single entry node. There should be a single entry point from which we can kind of get into the loop from the larger program. So let's see that with an example. So let's try to identify the natural loops in this particular control flow graph. So we can see that there are, you know, so this is, you know, in general, in this diagram, the control is flowing from top to bottom, but there are a couple of places where the control is flowing from bottom to top, and that is where we expect a cycle, and so that is where we also expect a loop potentially. And so one of the cycles is this one, and so it's made by these two basic blocks, right? So these two basic blocks. So if I call these, you know, let me just label them, say B1, B2, B3, B4, and B5, then the loop is formed by B4, the edge from B4 to B5, B5, and then the edge from B5 to B4. And then there are some other incoming edges of the loop, and then some other outgoing edges of the loop. That's also okay. But, you know, we are only, for our definition of a loop, we are counting those edges which are contained completely within the loop, right? So the edges are B4 to B5 and B5 to B4. And the nodes are B4 and B5. Okay, so this is one cycle. Is there any other cycle? Yes, there is this cycle B2, B4, B5, B2, B4, B5, right? So this is another cycle in the program. And you can say that there are more cycles. You can say B2, B4, B5, B4. You know, you can kind of, you know, have more cycles here. And so there are actually many cycles in this program. But if I just look at kind of the most obvious cycle, there are like two cycles. And let's try to identify which of these are actually natural loops, okay? So if I look at the first cycle, which is this cycle, B4 and B5, then it has how many entries? By entries, I mean from how many different nodes can the loop start executing. And you would see that the only node that, so let me just label this again, B1, B2, B3, B4, B5. So basically the loop basically enters from B4. So either it can enter on this edge or it can enter on this edge, but there's only one entry node. It cannot enter from B5, right? So there is no incoming edge into B5, except from the internal edges of the loop, which is from B4, right? So there's no extra external edge coming into B5. And so this actually satisfies our informal requirement of a loop, which is that there is a cycle and there is a single entry point. All right, so this is actually a natural loop. All right, now let's try to see. So the answer is yes, cycle one is a natural loop because there is a single entry point. Now let's look at the other cycle. Now this cycle, does it have a single entry point? So what is this cycle made of? Once again, let me just label this B1, B2, B3, B4, B5. So the second cycle is made up of B2, B4, B5. And what are the entry nodes? Okay, so you would see that there are actually two entry nodes. One is B2 because there's an external edge coming into B2, an edge that is not part of the loop. And then there is an entry edge from B4, right? Because there's an entry edge from B4 coming into the loop. And so this particular cycle has two entry points, okay? And if I consider this to be the first entry point, then this is like, this seems like it's jumping into the middle of the loop. So B2 is the entry point. If I consider, so there are two entry points, first of all, but if I say that B2 is kind of the main entry point or the first entry point, then B4 seems like, the entry into B4 seems like somebody can jump into the middle of the loop. And so that's what we want to avoid in a natural loop. We don't want people to be able to jump into the middle of a loop, because just like we don't want people to, other blocks to jump into the middle of a basic block, we also don't want other parts of the program to be able to jump into the middle of a loop. And we don't want this because if we maintain this property that nobody can jump into the middle of a loop, then that gives a nice structure to the loop and we can analyze the loop in isolation and do transformations on it. So the answer here is no. Cycle 2 is not a natural loop because, if we consider this as the first entry, then this looks like it's jumping to the middle of the loop. I could have also considered this as the first entry, in which case this would have looked like the end jumping into the middle of the loop. In either case, there are more than one entries, and so it is not a natural loop. So here is the good news. Most loops in common programs are natural loops, and that's why we are so interested in defining natural loops and then analyzing them and transforming them, because most loops in common programs are actually natural loops. All constructs, like, without using GoTo in a language like C, like for, while, do while, or other languages include repeat until, things like that, these are all constructs that only create natural loops. Notice that, if you construct a for loop, you only enter the loop from the header of the for loop. You cannot just jump into the middle unless you're using GoTo. And that's one of the reasons why GoTo usage is discouraged, because it kind of breaks the structure of the program, makes it much harder to reason about both the correctness and optimization possibilities of the program. So this is good news because the single entry property lends a nice structure to the natural loop. Now, I have defined a natural loop very informally so far. I'm saying there should be a cycle and then there should be a single entry point. But I think we need to have more formal definitions so that we can algorithmically identify all the natural loops in the program. Now, I also want to point out that in the example that I had shown earlier, there were more than two cycles. We also discussed there were other cycles, like maybe I can go around this and then I can go around that and so on. And so there are more cycles in that program. But all those cycles will have greater than one entries. And so none of them would also be natural loops. Okay. Now, to be able to define what is a natural loop, I need to define another relation, which is called the domination relation or dominate relation. And all, and the corresponding relationship is also called dominators. So node D, first of all, dominate is a relationship between two nodes in the control flow graph. and one node D dominates another node N in the control flow graph, if D, also this is also written as D dom N, if and only if every path from the start node of the graph or of the CFG to node N goes through D, right? So every path, every possible path, including paths that have loops and stuff, that reaches N from the start node has to go through D, in which case I would say that node D dominates node N. And also I'm going to assume that a node dominates itself. So dominator relation is actually a reflexive relation. All right, so let's look at an example. Here is a control flow graph. It has B1, B2, B3, B4, N. And then there is a loop and then there's a cycle here. Right? So this is a natural loop and this is not a natural loop. This is the same example that we've seen in the previous slide. Now, what are the dominators of N? Which one of these basic blocks, B1, B2, B3, B4, dominates N? So we want to ask the question. So this is the start of the program. So we want to ask the question, from the start of the program, what are the nodes that must be traversed before being able to reach N? And so one more thing is very clear. Actually, anything that you want to reach has to go through B1. So B1 will pretty much dominate everything, right? Including N. Okay, what about B1, B4? So let's look at this, right? So B1 dominates N. Can B2 dominate N? The answer is actually no, because here's one path that does not go through B2. B1, B3, B4, N. So it is possible to reach N from the start node without going through B2. And this is this path. Similarly, does B3 dominate N? The answer is no, because there is a path like this one, which goes through, which does not go through B3 and still reaches N. Actually, there are potentially infinite number of paths, right? Because I can go around cycle without going through B3 at all and still be able to reach N. But even if there was one such path, I say that it does not dominate, right? So B3 does not dominate N. Does B4 dominate N? The answer is yes, because I cannot create a path from the start node to N that does not go through B4, right? I have to go through B4 to be able to reach N. And finally, N dominates N. And this is just by our definition of domination that we are going to also assume that the node dominates itself. And, you know, intuitively, you cannot reach a node without actually visiting that node, right? So that's one way to think about it. But this reflexivity property is also easier to kind of reason about when we discuss our algorithms, etc.